Good evening and welcome to a new edition of To The Point. This evening we'll be discussing the extensive diplomatic agenda within this region. Lots of boiling points. With us this evening is a distinguished gentleman that will shed light on critical issues pertaining to this issue, and maybe topping those issues is the catastrophe in Syria. With us this evening is His Excellency Ambassador Mohamed Hegazy, former Assistant Foreign Minister. A pleasure to have you with us.
My pleasure, Dina.
Recently, a meeting, or actually today, a meeting was held in Kazakhstan for Syrian, to come up with a solution. And when I say come up with a solution, I may be saying it a bit reserved because lots of meetings have been addressing this issue and nothing has actually managed to even break through the deadlock in this conflict in Syria. As you were pointing out before we even went on air, the Syrian opposition did not even attend the meeting. And maybe here I have two questions. Do we negotiate with the Syrian opposition? Because from what we hear, most of the opposition that's on the ground are not really Syrian. And if you don't have a partner that is willing to negotiate, will you come out of the catastrophe?
Okay, Dina, thank you very much for putting this very important question on the same day of the Asitana meeting, in which, as you mentioned, the opposition did not appear. But the three parties that is in charge, the Asitana function is to find ways and means to observe the ceasefire that has been agreed upon between the government, the opposition, Turkey, Iran, and the Russian Federation is acting like a stadium representing different parties, the Russians and the Syrian government, and Iran is in one camp. Those are the patrons or custodians of the troops on the ground. The absence of the opposition, of course we negotiate with the opposition. This is the national opposition that has to be listened to. And this what has been the format in the previous Asitana two meetings. This is the third Asitana meeting. It's not about Geneva. A few days back, Geneva 4 took place, and the four fundamental agreement and consents were clear that there is possibly a way through. The Asitana as another format that is, or another forum that is dealing with the ceasefire on the ground, the entrance of the humanitarian assistance and the exchange of prisoners. So this is more or less like an on the ground negotiation process, different from the political process that is sponsored in Geneva. But between Geneva and the Asitana, there is another Geneva 5 coming on the 23rd of March, as declared by Stéphane de Mistura, the UN special envoy. But it's not about, to me, the Asitana attended by the opposition, or Geneva attended by everybody, or a competition between Geneva and the Asitana, although there is a qualification to each meeting that is different from each other. One is political, and the second is technical sort of on-the-ground negotiation. I think it is the lack of the political will of the international parties, regional parties, and local parties as well. So unless we have this international will, I don't think the format or the forum or the city hosting a negotiation will lead us anywhere, unless the two powers decides, the Russians and the Americans, and the regional power, Iran and Turkey, and hopefully the Arab countries also will get involved, and the Syrian and the opposition, local, regional, and international level. Unless the consensus is there to reach an agreement, we will remain witnessing a meeting following the other, affiliate following the other, or another call for another meeting today in Geneva, tomorrow in Asitana, and the day after back to Geneva.
Has there been any meeting when you say we want the different parties involved to have the political will to resolve the issue? Have we not said this when we talked about the Palestinian question, the catastrophe in Libya, the catastrophes that took place in Lebanon over the past years, the catastrophe that took place in Sudan and led it to its division, the catastrophe that took place to Iraq and led to its destruction. Which scenario of collective political will to resolve an issue can we say is a successful factor to be repeated with the Syrian conflict?
Let me narrow the analysis a bit just to give a precise answer. On the Geneva 4, they were a platform where international community, the Syrian government, the Russian, Turkey, Iran, as well as the Syrian opposition, even the military one, except the terrorist groups, al-Nusra and Daesh, where everybody agreed on fighting them soon after we reach a political agreement. However, everybody is now fighting Daesh. But the most important, the Geneva 4 was a format that everybody think that the UN-sponsored process, which have laid the foundation for four chapters, the transitional government, the constitution, the election in 18 months of the presidential election and parliamentarian election will take place. This foundation or four chapters were to be, and then the election will lead formulation of a new Syrian political process, a Syrian-Syrian dialogue that will lead to a political process. In Geneva 4, the hope was to follow suit in Geneva 5 on the 23rd, but here comes the Esetana as on the ground. Everybody attacked today in his inaugural speech the other party of not fulfilling or honoring his commitment. Russians did not control the party that she represents, which is the Syrian government, of course, the Iranian and Hezbollah forces, whom they have maybe form certain independent stance from the Russian and even from the Syrian government. So nobody controls the situation on the ground with the will to fulfill the commitment taken in Asitana 3 or even in Geneva 4. What is required now before the meeting on the Geneva 5 in Geneva next week, I think, is to talk. I think everybody also is waiting for the United States administration, the new Trump administration, to give its final words. What do they want? If it is truly to find a way through, they have to talk to Moscow. And if the consent between Russia and the United States will lead to any breakthrough, I think we are heading for a situation where the two powers has to talk to each other and a final peace deal should be struck between the parties.
Can we have any process when you have certain parties are even conflicting? I mean, the situation between Turkey and Russia is not really very good. And they're supposed to find way for the ceasefire, the continuation of the ceasefire, and hopefully some kind of a solution to this conflict. If they are main parties and they're in conflict with one another, isn't this further dividing the issue in Syria?
Let us agree on one thing. The solution has to be a political solution. There is no winner in a conflict that have truly caused us all this damage. But the future Syria has to be looked at from an equal point of view. There is no party that will dominate the scenery. And I think the competition that I can note between, even if they call Geneva 4 a political process and Asetana is on ground negotiation to attain a ceasefire and to supply humanitarian assistance and to exchange prisoners, I think this Asetana is to many a representation of a domination of Russia and a victory of the government of Syria, where they will lead the process through their own negotiation format as a TANA, while the internationally recognized process in Geneva, sponsored by the UN Special Envoy de Mistura, and behind there is other regional parties like Turkey, and of course the United States are all, and Europe, are all in favor of the Geneva process. This competition that is hidden and denied by everybody is there. Whether the Russian and the Syrian government after Aleppo will proclaim themselves victorious, or they will understand that a political solution that will accommodate the parties, the opposition who fought for 6 years, I don't think they will come up with nothing. And the regional sponsors, this is a regional proxy war, and this is an international proxy war as well, not only regional. So an accommodation of the outcome has to be understood and observed. I think what have happened in Geneva 4, though many have claimed that it was not successful, I think it was, because it laid the foundation through the four chapters we refer to. A transitional government, which is the claim of the, or the main aim of the opposition, was attained, although the Syrian government for many rounds of talks refused that. The second party, I think the fourth element, that chapter that I didn't refer to, is to examine the terrorist activities, which is usually a Syrian government claim, which has been accommodated in the four chapters of discussion in Geneva 5, which will come. So there is no parties should claim victory. Asetana to some represents the Russian-Syrian success or victory after Aleppo, and maybe the absence of the opposition is a way to wait for Geneva 5.
In the internationals, without going into names, interest to resolve this conflict?
I think they have to.
It's not in their back door.
The Trump administration position against terrorism, their clear mandate to end up the reign of Daesh and to maybe cool down the opposition activities and to maybe pressure Turkey to accept. Otherwise, the military confrontation will remain and it will render no victorious, and it will only leave us with the continuation for the 7 years in a row, a situation of misery and destruction, which we had enough in Syria. As we always say in our programs, that half of the population of Syria have been affected of this horrifying confrontations between parties, regional, locals, and international, where half of the population have been displaced, 7 million displaced, 5 million immigrants, and 400,000 to 700,000 killed in the battle. 25% of the children in Syria have been in this dilemma, affected in many ways. So we have to look at a future of a place that have been really a manifestation of our lack of diplomacy, our maybe war-mingle
whenever we see
mentality.
Such boiling points within the region, and maybe the examples are in the Palestinian territories, even the situation in Iraq, we don't see a way out. The conflicts have been there for tens of years, and unfortunately, the situation deteriorates, the country's resources are sapped. Most of the people, its nationals, end up living as refugees.
I would
subscribe. I don't want to draw a pessimistic picture.
It is.
Isn't this what we're... And it seems that Syria is being turned into another Iraq, for example.
Let me try to open up the dark image of the Middle East. It is true that there is an a UN-sponsored peace process in Yemen that is moving ahead. It is true that the Iraqi armed forces is successfully gaining momentum in Mosul, and it is closing in the battle. It is true that in Syria there is activities of all sorts, local, international, and regional, which will definitely lead us somewhere. Geneva IV have laid the foundation to a reasonable optimism. I have to talk about the Palestinian question while we are discussing. There is a U.S. special envoy visiting both Tel Aviv and Ramallah, meeting with Netanyahu this afternoon and traveling to Ramallah during the course of the day. So there is opening somewhere.
There is diplomatic efforts, but is there any solution?
I guess so. I mean, everybody understood that in this small geography, you cannot live with five conflicts. It is a threat to peace and security of the world community. We have seen what happened in Syria and the influx of refugees to Europe, as well as the humanitarian catastrophe that we have created ourselves. And no exception about condemning this party. We are all condemned because either we lack the political will or we didn't do enough. And the Syrian people are the one who paid the price. But let us move with those five conflicts where there is opening somewhere. There is a UN-sponsored peace process in Yemen that is progressing. In Iraq, the Iraqi army is progressing. The Daesh in itself is diminishing. And I think we need, after that, a Marshall Plan. A Marshall Plan that will reconstruct the Middle East. And with this Marshall Plan, Dina, I call always for a political Marshall Plan. We need a declaration of principles. How can we live together in the Middle East?
Who is supposed to guide us and lead to this declaration? Is it something like the Arab League, or how will we consolidate?
It can be the Arab League. It can be the Arab League. Mr. Abolgate is very enthusiastic about the region and its stability. He can lead a regional declaration of principles that show that no interventionists, no country should mingle in the internal affairs of others, Iran and Turkey in the Arab affairs. Let us be clear about that. And the international players should also pacify the Middle East, because this is where our international passage, trade passages are, in the Suez Canal and in other corners of this geography. Plus, this is where also the energy security lies, in the Gulf and many other places. And unless we work together to rebuild the Middle East, to not only to rebuild and construct from a physical point of view, but also from a political point of view. As I said, a declaration of principles that will guide non-interference in each other's affairs, respect of national sovereignty, and this is what is lacking in the Middle East. If we are to settle conflicts, we have to settle also on the principles that will guide our living in this geography. I will come to the Palestinian issue. It has been for some time now, almost 60 years with us, and we have to move forward in reinstating the two-state solution and to regain the support of the international community. They came clearly against settlement, and this is a very important international step last December in the UN Security Council, and we are now have to collectively, maybe in the Arab League coming summit, to reinstate the two-state solution through the Arab League initiative towards the Israeli-Palestinian cause. And I think the Arab peace initiative is still valid. We have to insist.
But do you have a party that is willing? Because for you to achieve peace, it cannot be done. It's not a one-sided solution.
It is not.
Because at the end of the day, you want a two-state solution. Indeed. If one party is not willing to negotiate, is not willing, even though at the surface, sometimes media talk, it claims it wants to find a solution, so forth and so on. But in reality, they don't want any solution. It's not in their interest to have a solution.
Well, the world community should have a voice. And I think the UN Security Council should carry its responsibility. And the new US administration also should introduce its say in the matter. The president, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, will be in Washington soon, as we learned.
Yes.
And I'm sure that this will open up gates and will introduce also ideas, and talking to the new administration about stabilizing the Middle East is always there. They learned a lot. As I said, there
Sorry to interrupt you, but will the new U.S. administration realize that Israel is more of a strategic liability than an ally?
No, I don't think we will reach to this conclusion anytime soon. What is important to say is that even if you are very concerned about the Israeli national security and future accommodation in the region, the two-state solution is your way through. What I meant is that the one-state solution is not a solution to the even the security of all the parties, because the concept of one-state solution is not one man, one vote, a democratic heaven where Palestinian and the Israelis, Arab and the Israelis will live together. Not at all. Mm. It is an apartheid concept in the mind of the right-wingers in Israel who think that we can observe the Palestinian. 3.5 million. How would you have thought to observe? Of course, if it is one man, one vote, we all welcome the one-state solution. But it's not that what is in the mind of the Israeli politician. If you read their literature, it's all about segregation, and a new apartheid system will be a threat even to the security of Israel. So the two-state solution, even from an American you recall the Secretary of State when he talked the previous administration when they talked about the two-state solution to protect the interest of Israel, not the one-state solution, which is a segregation system and an apartheid regime, which will definitely lead us nowhere but to more frustration. The war against terrorism has many variables. Yes. One is military and policing activities, defense-related issues. One is economic development. One is ideological confrontation. But the most and in the core is settling disputes. And the Palestinian, being the just cause, the oldest in the region, here is the main source of frustration and anger that allows terrorist groups to use. Look at what is happening in Sinai. What do they call themselves? Ansar Baitul Maqdis. Yes. And this is a show of how terrorism and terrorist activities can use the Palestinian cause or the Palestinian name, Jerusalem or Baitul Maqdis, as a manifestation of their activities or as a reflection of their final aim. What is true is that the settling of the Palestinian conflict is not only in the favor of the Palestinian people, but as well to the Israeli people and to the peace and stability of a region which is strategically very important to our international partners, particularly the Americans.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of the Americans and the fact that you raised the issue that President Sisi should be going to Washington within the next week or so, what do you expect to come out of this visit?
Well, it is a very important visit between two strategic partners. It has been clear to all our international partners that the views that Egypt has reflected and the policies and strategies it has adopted has proven successful and has proven true in all dimensions, in all conflicts. Egypt was calling for stabilizing the nation state in confronting terrorism and armed militias. Unless we all fight together this destabilizing factor of terrorism and armed militias, we will see the situation in Syria again. and will remain with the conflict in Yemen, Libya, Iraq. So I think Egypt's view not only to stabilize its political scenario and economy, but also to render support to Libya, to Syria, to Iraq, to observe the nation state. Of course.
Because he said nothing is for free. What's he gaining out of it?
Stabilizing the Middle East, as I said, the Middle East.
Is this to his advantage?
Of course. This is where our, as I said, trade passageways are. This is where your energy security lies. This is also where you have contributed in the past in the Middle East chaos that we are witnessing. I'm not only talking about the chaos, but about the human suffering because of certain policies that have used maybe terror groups and militias to attain political goals. And this has to be stopped. And when I always say that Daesh require an international investigation, we need to see who supplied, who supported, who financed.
Will the world international community, especially the United States, stand against countries that harbor and fund and support terrorism and their groups?
This is UN Security Council resolution. There is a call from the UN Security Council resolution to
will
stop
the United
finance.
States, with its new administration, back?
I think so.
When I say back, I'm not saying just in the United Nations for a resolution to pass, but in their policies.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, they're very good at imposing sanctions, for example, and they use this a lot.
I think when I said an international investigation, it is important to point out to countries that is supporting militias and terrorist groups to stop doing so, not to finance, being it individuals or countries. It has to be investigated in any war of this dimension, like the war on terrorism. Well, we have to stipulate and talk clearly about who's doing what. In all wars, there is always reports and investigation as to avoid in the future falling again into the same mistake. Again, I think, Dina, an international investigation will be a pressure on those countries that is still using terror groups to attain political goals.
Maybe one of the other issues that we want to talk about, and that is the future of the European Union. And the United Kingdom has voted for or reaffirmed the Brexit, so to speak. Does this mean that this is the end of the European Union? Because it seems that this trend is being even echoed by others, even though not actually yet applied. But it seems the idea is becoming attractive to other European nations. It's being encouraged by Donald Trump that they will be stronger as individual countries are than this bloc. Do you think that this is maybe the start of the end? What Britain did is like the domino effect that would be...
No, Dina, I differ on that. I think Europe is about unity. It's about the dream of the future. It's about stability. Europe have witnessed the nationalistic feelings and how destructive it is when it comes to nationalism prevail over unity. They have enjoyed for many years, and they can compare between what they have witnessed in the past. Besides, it's about shared responsibilities. If Britain, for some reasons, decided to pull out because they don't want to share their responsibilities in movements,
why
in refugees...
Why wouldn't others do this?
There is a call, even Marine Le Pen, the nationalistic leader in France, who is leading in the polls, is calling the same. We will consider the same.
It's contemplating the same issue.
Absolutely, and you can. The populist in all over the world, not only in Europe or the United States, they are in many parts of the world, are very much into this individualism, into this protectionism, into the feel of hating the other. And alienating themselves from sharing responsibilities. This field will remain, but I think Europe will stood firm. Countries like Germany, and France, with all the history and principles France advocated and claimed over all over its history, will resist, because I think the benefits of being united is by far than looking into the inner house problems, which can be easily solved in community rather than individually. I think many also talking about the risk Britain is taking economically. Even the integration of Scotland is one of the threatening party. However, we have to learn from the process. This is the first time a country of the size of Britain comes out. We have to study the repercussions.
Will there be negative repercussions?
I think I can see it when last week the Prime Minister of Scotland is asking for a new permission for a referendum. This in itself is about the disintegration as well as the investments and the fear of the economic future of the United Kingdom. But still, it's an important party to Europe. The defense policies will remain. I think if the exit is smoother and if an understandable and understanding of each other point of view, I think Europe will reach an accommodation which will allow the Brexit with minimum repercussions or minimum effect.
Let me play here sort of the devil's advocate and maybe question whether Donald Trump will encourage the trend, will encourage more countries to participate and follow suit.
The disarray in Europe will have a negative effect on world economy.
Why?
Because, of course, this is a process that will destabilize a system, a monetary system, a legal system, a political dimension, also a role of an entity that has proven very important to peace and stability in the world international affairs. Yeah. So I don't think that President Trump, look at his talk about the NATO and the return back to say that I'm asking only for a shared responsibility, meaning that the NATO is important.
So he's and backing out of what he said during the campaign?
It's not backing completely, but it's asking more contributions, which is acceptable to Europe. The Chancellor have said that we have to accommodate. Chancellor Merkel have said that we have to accommodate certain responsibilities. I think it is safe to say that it is now five countries that paying their contribution. The rest has to carry more responsibilities. Within this context, I can understand that the Trump view to the NATO from a technical point of view is acceptable, financial point of view, I mean, but from a strategic point of view, the transatlantic remain very firm and strong, and it can be stronger. But as many says that the transatlantic is not a financial issue, it is more about commitment. And what I have learned that the new administration have calmed down the fears that a pullout might happen, and the visit of the foreign minister and the vice president to Brussels last month was a clear reflection of what I've said.
What are you predicting when it comes to how constructive the visit to the United States will be? And the reason I'm saying this is because yesterday, for example, the New York Times did not have a very good review of Egypt and the political evolution, if I can put it that way, since February, since the January 25th revolution, so to speak. And it went back to using terminology like the coup against the legitimate will of the people, lack of democracy, whatever. It seems they're paving the way for negative vibes. They're reawakening the negative vibes in the American public opinion before President Sisi hits Washington.
The Washington Washington Post, the New York Times, who remain since the 30th of June revolution in the negative side of Egypt, have proven to be wrong in many ways. The stabilization of the political situation occurred contrary to their prediction. Even President Trump himself has a negative view on what is written in those medias.
They attack him personally. I mean, the media is not in support of the American president.
What I wanted to say is that it is not always. Remember that we discussed in a similar program The Economist and the way they have criticized our country and the economy. And here is The Economist last week talking very positively about
the
Egyptian.
Yes, it gave us a good prediction.
What Egypt represents that has to be taken into consideration in the political analysis of any fair media is that we are a country that have carried our responsibility and in the forefront of confronting terrorism, which destabilized country like Syria and caused the influx of refugees that Europe are suffering from. We are a country that are not supporting our internal affairs, but supporting the internal affairs of the whole region to stabilize the Middle East for the benefit of all its people. We are questing for a peaceful solution to all the ongoing conflicts. Besides, we carried our responsibilities to improve our economy, to reconstruct in cooperation with International Monetary Fund, a new restructuring program that have put on us many responsibilities, and our people carried it in conformity with their leadership. If that does not really reflected in the New York Times, so this is the biased media.
Sir, another maybe issue is what can be done right now from the Arab League's point of view? In other words, there is a lot of momentum or pushing for a momentum within the United Nations. You have a new American administration that, as you are saying, could be of support of stabilizing this region, seeing more benefit in stabilizing this region. You have the world that is for the first time, and the United Nations issued a resolution condemning Israeli atrocities and the building of settlements in Palestinian territories. Yet, I don't want to be unjust, but we have to say that we don't have a strong collective Arab momentum. And here we're talking about the Arab League as it is the dome under which all the Arabs are present. And can we actually get the Arab political will to unify? Can we have this political will?
I think this is the very difficult task ahead of Mr. Abolgeit and other Arab leaders. We cannot really put all the pressure on the Arab League to create this commonality.
Well, it's a forum for the Arabs. It's a reflection of us.
So I agree.
I mean, I'm just saying that the Arab League as an umbrella, as the title.
Yeah, but the title and the umbrella requires always the joint political will of the leadership. If we are in disarray and differences, we remain so, and the Arab League will reflect this status. And if we are somehow talking to each other, about our differences, about our commonalities and synergies that exist between us, then the Arab League will act faster. And we have a driving force, a new Secretary General whom we both know, very determined and very genuine in his ideas and initiatives. So let us hope for Amman, the summit on the 29th of March, to be a reconciliation summit, a summit that the Arab communities and the Arab League will find a place in the end game. Because, as I said, in Syria, there is a very important effort soon after the Trump administration clarify its position. I see an opening in Syria, same in Yemen, amendments to the UN-sponsored plan might get us to shore. The Libyan situation is somehow there, the tripartite stabilizing player, the regional powers, Egypt, Tunisia and Algeria are closing in ranks. And I guess that we have witnessed today the defeat of the military militia in eastern Libya, in the oil fields, Ras Lanuf and other places. So there is a hope in Libya more than other places. So if we can open up direct negotiation based on UN legalities or Arab League initiative, where pressure will be exerted, when the president also talked to the Trump administration, and of course we can bring parties to a meaningful discussion that will lead us somewhere in the Palestinian issue. Mm. Having said that, the Arab League should, and the Arab countries should, have their place in the end game and in the solution. I am convinced that the UN represents us all, but I would also like to see an Arab component in Syria trying to assist, an Arab component to the UN-sponsored
program.
Wouldn't
this be better for the Syrian issue if it's an Arab component rather than an international component?
It is getting very late to agree with you, Dina, to tell you the truth.
We left it too late.
It is now very complicated. There is local conflict between the government and Syrians seeking democracies, and I think an accommodation should be met internally. There is regional proxy war led by Iran and its militias somewhere, and also other Gulf states. So we have to also agree regionally that no interventions in Arab affairs will be the key to stability and the key to avoid future conflicts. As I said before, Iran and Turkey should remain and refrain from interfering and mingling in the Arab affairs. This is very important. And when I spoke about reconstruction, I spoke also about political reconstruction, where guiding principles should be adopted to govern the relations between us in the Arab world and our regional partners, particularly Turkey and Iran. The Palestinian-Israeli question will remain with us till we exert more effort and we come with innovative openings to a deadlock that is now foreseen. The right-wing government, it's not a forgotten situation or a situation that we have to build all our calculation. A reconstruction of the Israeli internal politics can be also a way forward. Zionist camp, as well as Mr. Netanyahu, before had a joint and common program that can open up gates. We don't have to stuck with the far right in Israel. It's not a permanent status.
But is it not hindering any progress in any negotiations?
Yeah, let the Israeli internal politics play its toll, but let us at the same time introduce to the table a meaningful ideas that will be attractive to both parties. We have to assist the two parties to understand that peace is the only and lasting solution. Look at Egypt peace treaty with Israel. Look at the Jordanian peace treaty with Israel. Mm. Why don't you try it with the Palestinian? Why don't the Israeli try that with the Palestinian?
Your Excellency, you just mentioned something important, and that is getting the people involved in the issue. Do the Israeli people, or are the Israeli people, aware that it is in their interest to find the solution?
I think if the solution or the propositions
They reach the people? The average layman here, I'm talking about the average layman, that is really the one that suffers, by the way, because the decision maker is not the one that is attacked or whose family's lives are being wasted or whatever. Do they understand, the average layman?
Let us always be trustful of those camps, the peace camp in Israel and elsewhere, although all the indications are leading you to the contrary. But peace is part of our composition, human beings, and this is the key to stability. I am not talking from an emotional point of view here. I am talking about peace as a strategic choice. And when the Arab said it is our strategic choice, it's not out of weakness. It is about more realistic approach to stability.
Yes.
If Israel today decides to be part of this region, the Palestinian question is the key, where open borders and economic integration and movements even of people can be envisaged. Otherwise, we will remain in this ghetto kind of policies where right-wingers will dictate, and I'm sure that the Israeli society at a moment where the Arab Peace Initiative is introduced with the support of the international community, with some concessions from both parties, we can reach a solution. There is no possibility that we remain where we are in now.
Mm-hmm. Your Excellency, unfortunately, our time is up. A pleasure indeed to have you with us this evening on To The Point, and very fruitful input. Thank you very much for joining us. I'd like to thank you, the viewers, and we'll see you same time next week. Until then, good night.